10 seconds. Please stand by. Good evening, everyone. We now have the school board and staff in conference. Please be aware that each public line is in listen-only mode. At the appropriate time in the meeting, instructions will be given by the operator for the members of the public to make comments to the school board. I would now like to turn the board meeting over to Chair Baudouin. You may begin.
Thank you. Welcome. Now is the time to check your cell phones and put them on mute. Our vision statement is all our students achieve success, college, career, and life. The thought for the day is by Mr. Altman.
Good evening. I have two of them this evening. They're both very short. The first one is, believe it or not, a Charlie Chaplin quote that says, "Nothing is permanent in this wicked world, not even our troubles." And the second one was an unknown author, but it says, "Even the darkest hour only has 60 minutes."
Thank you, Mr. Altman. Please stand. We have a flag on our screen, and I hope you do too. So please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the
flag
of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All board members are participating. Now I'm going to ask for a moment of silence for Jim Mead, retired guidance counselor from Pasco High School. I would also ask to keep all those in Pasco and across the world who are impacted by COVID-19 in our thoughts. Thank you. I want to note that pursuant to Executive Order 2069 and 2091, the Superintendent Emergency Action of April 2nd, 2020, and the School Board Action taken April 7th, 2020, a quorum of school board members will participate via an operated guided conference call. This temporary rule remains in effect at least through the next meeting. I'm offering a few suggestions to help this meeting run smoothly. Please keep your phones muted when you are not speaking. To my fellow board members, when making a motion or a second, please state your name. For example, say Altman, I move, or Crumbly, second. I will do roll call for voice votes in alphabetical order. So we'll go Altman, Armstrong, Crumbly, Harding, and I'll go last. Thank you for your patience and flexibility. I know this is difficult, but we will conduct business as close to usual as possible. I need a motion to approve the minutes of the April 7th meeting.
Armstrong,
a motion by Armstrong. I need a second.
Harding, second.
Altman, second.
Motion by Armstrong, second by Harding. Okay, now indicate aye for in favor and nay for opposed, and I'll go in order. Altman?
Aye.
Armstrong?
Aye.
Crumbly?
Aye.
Harding?
Aye.
And Baudouin is aye, so motion carries. There are no public hearings or special presentations, so I'm going to turn this over to Attorney Alfonso for public comment.
Before I read the announcement for public comment, I'd like to ask the operator if anyone has from the public indicated an intent to participate in public comment.
No, sir. We have no one queued up at this time.
Then, Madam Chair, I'll defer that statement then.
Thank you. At this time,
Madam Chairman, if I may, the operator needs to alert
the public that the opportunity to speak and how they need to get into the queue. We haven't done that on that call yet.
Okay. All right, then if it's all right, Madam Chair, I'll go ahead and read the script, and if no one is on, they're not on. So I apologize.
You're good.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the opportunity for the public to be heard on any items appearing for action on this evening's agenda. If you have any materials that you wish to share with the board, please email them separately to the board secretary for distribution to board members after the meeting. Each speaker will have 3 minutes during this segment of the agenda, and I will serve as timekeeper. Prior to making your remarks, please state your name and address for the record. All speakers and comments are subject to applicable school board policies regarding civility and decorum. At this time, we could receive public comment if the operator would assist at this time for the announcement.
John, we need you to read that statement.
Yes, ma'am. At this time, the board will receive public comments on agenda items only. If you would like to make a comment, please press the star key followed by the one key on your touchtone phone now. Callers will be taken in the order in which they are received. If at any time you would like to remove yourself from the queue, please press star two. We have no comments in the queue at this time.
Thank you. At this time, we would mention any written comments that were received, but none were received when I asked for them last night. So we're moving on to USEF, and I believe Mr. Peace is on the call. If you could speak now, please.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso, Chair Boglin, honorable board members and district staff, good evening. I hope you and your families are in good health. I would like to start by just making a couple of comments on the governor's decision for schools to remain closed for the remainder of the year. I do think it was a smart and well thought out decision and the right one to make in light of the health crisis. In part, that decision was made on the strength of the distance learning programs that have been put in place all across our state. I must say again that based on what I am hearing from other local presidents, Pasco is at the top of the list in our efforts to transition to online programs. A special thanks to all who have been diligently working to come up with the fixes for the few hiccups we've had in our transition. Help has been swift and efficient. I also think that during this time of distance learning, it should be cause for us to slow down a bit and be thankful for some of the things we often take for granted. We should be thankful for our health in light of the many who have and are suffering. We should be thankful for our families and make the best use of our time together. We should also be thankful for the people we work with and all the help and support we offer to each other. I think this bond has really lightened the load for everyone during this new way of learning. I think that our parents and grandparents who are working with students at home have also found a new appreciation for the role that all of our educators have had in the life of their students. Sometimes it's really good just to stop and smell the roses. I would concur with Superintendent Browning that the rollout has been pretty positive. Again, I want to thank district staff for your help in solving issues relating to the new normal. We have constant communication and are addressing concerns as they arise. Now that we know how the year will play out, we can turn our attention to the summer and beyond and begin planning for the future. Hopefully, our education budget doesn't take a great hit from this crisis. The governor has said he plans to keep his education goals in the forefront, and we are optimistic that that will happen. It appears our funding concerns will be on hold until late in the summer. Bargaining could be a real challenge for us for next year. It has been our joint goal with the district to provide employees with financial security, provide for a safe environment for those who do have to report to work sites, and to give our students the best opportunity to continue their education despite other obstacles. I think that together we are holding the course. For that, I want to thank all of you for what you do for our students, our employees, and our parents.
Thank you, Mr. Peace. Before we begin our committee reports, I'd like to once again say a few words on behalf of the board to recognize the efforts of our Pasco County Schools family. Our students, families, teachers, and staff have continued to work together to provide learning opportunities for students, as well as attending to their basic needs of supplying meals, devices, and taking mental health into consideration. We recognize that this is not an easy task, and we appreciate all members of our Pasco family. Although in normal circumstances, we would not have chosen to finish the school year using the distance learning model, we recognize that it is necessary for the safety and well-being of our families and staff. So thank you all for your flexibility, compassion, and grace. And for our board member reports, again, I'm going to go in alphabetical order. So Mr. Altman.
Good evening. The only thing I have to report tonight is that the Value Adjustment Board has heard final appeals, and the last case was resolved last week. And so we are scheduled to meet by phone on May the 8th to certify the county tax rolls and send that forward. So there'll be no delay in that process. So I think we're good there. And that's it, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Altman. Mrs. Armstrong?
Yes, hi. The wellness Student Wellness Policy Committee meeting was canceled. On the legislative issues, the FSBA has two recorded legislative session summary updates, Part 1, Education Appropriations, and Part 2, Education Legislation. There are links on the website to those two recorded sessions. And then you can also print out the print version and follow along with the speakers. The budget has not been sent to the governor, as he wants to wait for general revenue reports to come in before he exercises his veto powers. The Federal CARES Act funding for education totaled $30 billion, split evenly between K-12 and higher education. That's for the nation. And the funding will need Florida legislative action before we can receive that money. That's all for me.
Thank you, Mrs. Armstrong. Mrs. Crumbly.
I have no committee reports tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Harding.
Yes. Thursday, the Charter Task Force meeting group met, committee met, and there was lots of positives that happened there. The presence learning that I talked about, that talked about psychologists being digital, even before distant learning, many charter schools were saying I was doing great. It was really awesome. Last time I talked to you guys, they talked about Crisis Go, and they were trying to get that up and going in some of their campuses, because some of them didn't know that they had access to it. The one thing that I think Mr. Youngman's going to ask about is one of the charter schools asked if the flip charts online, if they could have a date at the bottom so they know that they're up to date. Other than that, some of the things that we talked about were about food and nutrition services. We talked about the how if charter schools do not elect to receive food and nutrition services provided by an external vendor, would they be able to conduct this on their own? And the answer is yes, but they would have to pay a fee and they would be by themselves. Some other things we talked about was they still really want to figure out a way that they could link their own, they use Schoology, which is kind of like our Canvas. They want to link it with My Students. So they opened that back up to see what, even if they have to pay a fee, to see what that would, if we could possibly do that. We also talked about the Educational Facility Security Grant and any updates as to the status of the approval, because it's nearing the end of the time for them to spend their funds. And so we're working on getting them an answer for that. But other than that, it was a really great meeting. That's all.
Thank you, Mrs. Harding. I had a student progression plan meeting. First, there was a discussion on creating uniformity for National Junior Honor Society and National Honor Society. It's still a work in progress and is in a committee. This isn't really part of the SPP, but the subcommittee came out of that group. While I'm pleased that the committee is looking at standardizing this process and requirements, I have some reservations, and I shared those concerns about the integrity of the society and upholding high expectations for the four pillars: scholarship, leadership, service, and character. I followed up with staff, and it is my understanding this committee is going to meet again to address some of these concerns. As far as SPP, Student Progression Plan, we continued to work in our subgroup, and I'm in the high school subgroup. We actually had to meet a second day to get through all the information. A request came to our committee to add a requirement that would require all students enroll in a course that provides potential to earn an industry certification and or college credit prior to graduation. The high school subcommittee had a robust discussion on this request. We acknowledge that many of our students will meet this goal because of the district's choice to offer the ACE, or General Paper course, the Cambridge course, and not English 3 at our brick and mortar campuses. However, some students will opt for English 3 online, hopefully at Pasco eSchool. We also have to consider students who transfer into Pasco from other places, different counties, states, or even countries. Those who don't want to take the ACE General Paper course or other college-level courses are limited only to the CTE offerings at their high school. This is not equitable. We promote choice, and this goes against that. We're limiting their choices. As it is, our students have less time for electives than some of our neighboring districts. If it's required, and some of these comments are coming from people in the committee, it could potentially lead to unintended consequences. In our committee, there was concern about the possible decrease in graduation rates because not all students may meet this requirement. Would we really withhold diplomas? Could we even legally do that? I'm not convinced that this is good for all kids. I've expressed my concerns on numerous occasions. Our subcommittee is recommending the following language in lieu of making a new graduation requirement. This is what we are recommending out of our committee. Every attempt will be made to ensure a student earning a standard diploma has the opportunity to enroll in a course that provides the potential to earn an industry certification and or college credit prior to graduation. Beginning in the 2020-2021 school year, all juniors will have the opportunity to enroll in the ACE General Paper to earn college credit. I'm sharing this information because I want my colleagues to have time to think about this before it comes to us for a vote this summer. I want to thank the SPP committee members for their work, their attention to detail, and their commitment to our students' best interests. Now I'll hand this over to Superintendent Browning for your comments.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. One thing that I wanted to bring to your attention is I'm requesting an off-agenda item regarding the charter school contract amendment for Dayspring Academy. Dayspring Academy is, we have just wrapped this up. My apologies for bringing it on as a walk-on, but it is somewhat timely that I'd like to get this wrapped up. The charter amendment is actually changing the student enrollment numbers from 900 to 920 for next school year, and then it goes from 920 to 1,200 students maximum 21-21 school year. So I would request that when you get to item number 15 on the agenda, that you would take this as an off-agenda item. This item was emailed to you earlier today, late this afternoon. If you accept it as an off-agenda item, this item will be 15.2 on the agenda. So, Madam Chairman, with that, I'd like to just update the board on just a couple of things. Obviously, you are all aware that the governor had recommended that schools be closed, school buildings be closed the remainder of the school year. And I think it's an important point, and I continue to press this point. because the news media has not done a job with it, but that school buildings are closed, but learning has not stopped. Students will continue to be engaged until May 27th, which is the last student day in the Pasco district. I know that this extended time of having kids out of school has been trying at best on our parents of our students. I know that it's been trying at best on our teachers and our staff, but we have really, as I said at the last board meeting, risen to the occasion. I want to thank our teachers, our administrators, and our district staff for their efforts to make distance learning as seamless as possible. I will echo what Mr. P said previously, and that is that when you hear or see what's going on in other districts, Pasco has a great deal to be proud of. I also want you to know that staff is working with our principals to develop a schedule for students to come to the school to clean out lockers, turn in equipment such as band equipment, uniforms, textbooks, etc. The principals will be notifying students of this schedule soon. And it may look a little different. I just wanted you to know that we are working on that schedule. We're not going to have a mass entrance into the schools to clean lockers out and turn in equipment, but it's going to be an organized process driven in large part by our principals. Additionally, principals will also be developing a schedule for teachers and staff to come into the school and clean and pack classrooms up. I believe that starts on the 28th, a week from today. Principals will be getting much more information out to the teachers and staff very, very soon as they finalize those plans, and they will get those out to them as well. Finally, I just want to update the board on where we are with graduations. If there has been, in the recent week or two, if there's been one single topic that has garnered the most attention by the superintendent and superintendent staff, it has been that of graduations. It has not gone silent on this superintendent or the staff about how important graduations are to the senior experience. We respect that and we understand that. The difficulty that this district and the staff finds ourselves in is with the COVID-19 virus and the restrictions that have been placed on our communities and society as a whole, while still trying to maintain some semblance of tradition. I will tell you that staff continues to work on graduation plans. We had a lengthy discussion about it today. Matter of fact, once, I think twice. We know that students and parents are anxious to know what these plans are. Because we're having to comply with the CDC's guidelines regarding the assembling of large crowds and as well not knowing when these restrictions will be relaxed or lifted, we are planning for graduations in August, giving our students the opportunity to walk across the stage and receive their diplomas. A virtual celebration is being planned in the interim. We believe that it's important to mark the final week of school with a celebration. So staff is working on a virtual celebration leading up to the last week, which would be our normal graduation season. As soon as the dates are set in August, we will push those dates out to moms and dads and to students and to school administrators. Right now, we are still trying to tie up loose ends, but we are actually further along this afternoon than we were this morning on that. So with that, that concludes any remarks that I have. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Superintendent. Mr. Gadd, do you have anything?
I just wanted to make the board aware that in the next couple of days following this board meeting, I'll be calling each board member to discuss with them a couple of land items that will be on the next agenda. One of those being the Angeline track that is a part of the Project Arthur that you've heard so much about on the Bexley property. And then we also have an additional land issue slash purchase that we're looking at in the old Pasco Road area. So I'll be calling you to explain both of those. In addition, I just wanted to give you a heads up that the district will be partnering with Sheriff Chris Nocco, as well as tax collector Mike Fasano, Representative Artie and Zika, and Senator Simpson to initiate a food drive. Even though we've been very successful at feeding our students, we remain concerned that as summer approaches, it's going to become more difficult. So Mr. Fasano is donating a bunch of food. We're going to initiate this food drive. We've also reached out to some not-for-profits around the state that are shipping fresh produce throughout the state and are trying to make connections with them and are very optimistic that that's going to occur. So Mr. Haggerty will let you know in the next few days exactly when that food drive is going to be and what the parameters will be. That's it for me.
Thank you, Mr. Gadd. Mr. Shibley.
Just two items very quickly. An update on the device distribution to students. We are now just shy of 18,000 computers that we have issued to students to aid them in distance learning. We are continuing to have schools enter units, devices that they have distributed to students, so I expect that number to continue to creep up in the coming weeks. And in terms of the agenda, there is an addendum to item 10.1 that has been uploaded to Board Docs and is a part of your agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Shibley. Mrs. Coon?
Mm-hmm. Good evening. I have a few updates, and I'll start with our feeding program that we have. Today was our fifth week of meal service since school closed. Just to give you a recap of where we've been. The week of March 23rd, we served approximately 5,500 students per day with our original feeding sites. We began once a week feeding on March 31st in an effort to promote social distancing, and we served 80,680 meals to over 8,000 students at 27 sites and 15 bus stops. That then takes us to today, when we served 14,300 students. And so that's over 143,000 meals, and that is very close. It's actually down a little from last week, about 2,000 down from last week, but I think that's means that we're hitting our stride and we can really effectively plan and prepare for that. And so one number I wanted to share with you is that all in all, we have served over 536,202 total meals since our school closure began. As Mr. Gadd said, we've started receiving some donations. Last week, we were able to serve fresh corn in our food servings, and we also served cucumbers and smoothies this week. So we're hoping that students are enjoying those treats. We also will be opening Connerton as a site next Tuesday, April 28th. For the first time, we have had a huge demand in the central area. We served 1,400 students today at Pineview Elementary, and so we will be opening Connerton. Additionally, wanted to let you know that, and we will publicize this as we get closer, but we will be feeding on May 19th and then reopening again on June 2nd with some modifications for summer feeding. So there will be a period of time when we will not be serving. There'll be 1 week, and then we'll be reopening on June 2nd with modifications for summer feeding, and we will certainly let you know more about that when we have details. I'd like to thank FNS leadership and staff, school leaders and staff, employee volunteers from departments all across the district, Rotary volunteers, and also the Pasco Sheriff's Office for their support, as well as our municipal police departments. They've been at every feeding site and every bus stop since it began. Additionally, I'd like to share an update with you regarding Fox Hollow Elementary and the traffic safety information that I shared that we discussed at the public hearing, and wanted to give the board an update regarding the request for a crossing guard at Regency and Fox Hollow Drive. In February, the Traffic Safety Committee discussed the issue and planned for a traffic study. However, with the closure on March 13th and now not returning back to school this school year, we did speak with the county, and I spoke with Mike Funk, and he agreed to put a crossing guard at that intersection pending a traffic study, so there will be someone there during the first few weeks of school. So that is good news there as well. Additionally, wanted to let you know that we have an extension grant for our 21st Century sites run by Mary Gray and the After School Enrichment Program. And we plan to reapply for those sites. We should hear for those programs sometime this summer. And then finally, I wanted to bring to your attention item 11.1. It is the construction management shortlist for 5 projects at Gulf Highlands, Hudson High, Northwest, Marlow, and Hudson Middle. Mr. Altman sits on that committee, and they did a lot of work over 2 days, and we are excited to begin negotiations for those projects. Thank you very much.
Mrs. Kuhn, thank you. All good news. Excellent. Dr. Moore.
Thank you.
Good evening, board members. Yes, I'm here. First, I want to thank you for this opportunity to share what's going on in the world of CTE. And I'd like to start off with thanking our outstanding CTE teachers and our great department, because as most of you are aware, CTE courses are really designed to be more hands-on courses, and that has put our teachers in a challenging position as we have moved into the world of distance learning. But I'm here to tell you today that our teachers have done an outstanding job and have really stepped up and are doing great and wonderful things for our students. And we are just so proud of the work that our teachers are doing, as well as what our CTE staff is offering in the way of support to help our teachers create those engaging lessons for our students. So some things that are going on in the world of CTE is we now have a CTE/adult ed newsletter, and it's called The Connector. I'll send a copy of that to you tomorrow so that you can read it. This will be a monthly newsletter that we will be sending out to our teachers around the district. We're continuing our work on our comprehensive local needs assessment. This is required by the new Perkins 5 grant, and we'll be conducting our unpacking sessions with SREB, which are scheduled right now for May the 12th, and we'll be doing that via Zoom. The next board meeting, we will be bringing to you our CTE Student of the Year, which we're very excited about. Our CTE program administrators are reporting that CTE teachers have transitioned well to the distance learning environment, which I've already shared, and we're excited about what we're creating for our students. And the last thing is we are currently working along with assessment on an at-home industry certification test. We're developing a plan for that in conjunction with assessment based on the guidelines put out by the DOE. So we're excited about the great work that's continuing in our world of career and technical education.
Thank you, Dr. Moore.
And that's it for me.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. All good again. Mrs. Swinson.
Yes, ma'am. I'd just like to share one item with the board. We completed the refunding of one of the CUPS series for $30,605,000 last week. We were able to get the refunding for 10 years at 1.77%. So that's about a 2% savings for the board over the next 10 years. Thank you. That's all I have.
Excellent news. Thank you. Mrs. Hilton.
Good evening, board members. I am going to give you an update on our distance learning plan. First, I'll just remind you, we're entering week 4, or we did yesterday. We definitely have some trends in the data. Monday engagement is always higher for each week so far. Isn't that funny? Because usually Mondays would be a slow day for folks. But we do have students engaged throughout the week. So even on Saturday and Sunday, we averaged 20,000 to 36,000 participations, which are actions of engagement. Overall, in week 3, we had about 98% engagement of our students. And this week, we are in the process of issuing hotspots to families that you approved the purchase of. So thank you so much. Our families without internet, those will be prioritized initially for some of our homeless families and families that really are away from where there would be infrastructure for internet. And then very soon we'll be establishing, in conjunction with the Office for with Otis very soon, 5 community assessment hubs around our county, 4 on the east side, 1 on the west side, where families, students could come to access at a particular point. Since day one, I wanted to let you know we have had over 43 million page views in access of files, and just under 15 million modules access, so modules of units of study. We've had 7,278,753 assignments submitted, 4,438,379 engagements in discussions, and 1,214,552 announcements, which are direct communications from teachers and leaders to the students and families that we miss so much. Through feedback from families and students themselves, very resourceful students themselves and staff, we have made adjustments as we've gone, particularly to our elementary workload to minimize stress and ensure that learning continues. We've also, as I think many of you know, been creating weekly parent newsletters, teacher newsletters, as well as a periodic secondary student newsletter directly related to resources, tips, and access information to help our students learn better and our parents and teachers support them better. Our teachers also have their own collaborative space on Facebook that is an incredibly impressive evidence of their sharing and learning together across the district. And I think that Mr. Peace made reference to that, and I could not agree more about the collaboration across our district. It's amazing. For a real quick, more recent update, on Monday, students submitted 111,150 assignments. We had almost 66,000 users working across the day. And at the peak time, which is about midday for us, almost 21,000 students were learning at the same time together. And in fact, right now, we have over 8,000 unique users, meaning individuals are right now learning as we speak. A huge thank you to all of our stakeholders for their commitment to keeping our students learning, including you. Thank you so much.
Mrs. Hilton, thank you so much for sharing all that information. I've seen that collaboration too, and all those assignments you're talking about, we know that there's a lot of grading going on. So I just want to echo thank you to you, and thank you to all our teachers and leaders who are working hard on that. Ms. Hetzler-Nettles.
Hello, good evening. I also would like to thank our school teams and the collaboration that they have demonstrated with food and nutrition services and feeding and with the distance learning as echoed. I would like to add on to the distance learning by saying I'm sure that you've seen the many examples, the creative ideas that the staff and teachers have provided for students and families to have a variety of live lesson options and to have some student interaction with their peers. Specifically today, I've seen many examples around the country of people singing and song, and I was thrilled to see Rushi Middle School teacher Mr. Roush was working with his students on their production from Charlie Brown, and the students were all on screen singing True Happiness. It was really a wonderful example to see. Pineview Middle School staff development is still going on. It's going on at all our schools, but they had a surprise pop-in during a Zoom last week where author Tom Schimmer joined them in their book study as they are reading Grading from the Inside Out as a book study group in their PLC. So that was a surprising pop-in from the West Coast at a very early hour for Mr. Schimmer, and we appreciated that. And then finally, I want to wish all of our administrative professionals a happy Administrative Professionals Day tomorrow and let them know that we are definitely still very appreciative of them in this virtual environment. And although we don't see them daily personally, they are certainly still working very hard in our school teams to support the students and the teachers in the learning going on.
Thank you. Mrs. Poe.
Yes, I just wanted to inform everyone that we did push our in-person kindergarten registration day from April 20th to July 8th. Parents can definitely still engage in the process virtually by accessing an online form that can be found on each of our elementary school's websites. But we definitely look forward to seeing our incoming kindergartners on our campuses in July for that in-person registration day. Also wanted to note that our elementary schools are continuing to work with students and families in very creative ways, not only to connect and instruct in meaningful ways, but they're also addressing any stress or concerns that are being experienced during distance learning. These efforts, of course, will be ongoing throughout the end of the school year, but they're definitely being very attentive to individual needs of families and students and very willing to work with them in very specific and individual ways. So we appreciate that. And then our superintendent already touched on the fact that, yes, although our campuses may be closed, our schools are definitely very much open. And my appreciation continues for the elementary students, their parents, their families, and our school's teachers, staff, and leaders who are working so hard to ensure that our youngest students, our students aged pre-K through fifth grade, are still learning and growing each and every week. Thank you. That's all I have this evening.
Thank you, Mrs. Poe. Dr. Isle.
Yes, thank you very much. I will say that as a whole, I am proud to work in Pasco County. I know everyone has spoke about all of the teachers' efforts to get online up and running, and administrator and other assistants in providing support to make sure students are accessing and then doing the work they need to do and assisting families. So we are very lucky on how well things are going. I did want to highlight just a couple of things happening at some of the schools. As you know, we had to cancel Grad Bash. However, at Sun Lake High School, the seniors had fundraised for the cost of the buses to go to Grad Bash, and they have elected and decided as a class that they would like to take that portion of the funds and donate it to the Keystone Community Church Second Serving. This is an organization that feeds homeless and those in need. And I think it just speaks to our graduating class that we have of how much they're thinking about how they can give back to the community. And on another note, something to look out for is our Mitchell's Band will be doing a virtual concert series in the upcoming weeks. So I'll be sending that information out to all of you so you can see what that looks like and get to hear some great music.
Thank you, Dr. Isle. That's really impressive about those Sun Lake students. We're looking forward to hearing more from Mitchell. Thank you. Dr. Skanga?
I'll just share a story. One of our principals, well, actually, I'll tell you who it is. It's Mr. Clough, is reading every night to the children. He's reading Little House on the Prairie, which I thought was a excellent book to choose in terms of a family that's rather isolated and dependent on themselves to entertain and to survive. So, but I think one of the things that is working in terms of engaging families, even if they're having a little bit of difficulty with the coursework, is that teachers and administrators are finding fun ways to engage, which I think is a good inroad to connect to the families and try to then eventually coax them into the campus courses and doing work. So a lot of creativity out there, but I wanted to share that one story. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Skanga. Yes, I've seen a lot of the principals and their staffs reading to our students and families. It's excellent. Okay, we have no expulsion recommendations or hearings. So we are moving to the consent agenda. Is there any board member who would like to have any items removed from the consent agenda? Okay, hearing none. Hearing none, I need a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Brumbly, so moved.
Armstrong, second.
Thank you. And now I will do the roll vote. So indicate aye or nay. Altman.
Aye.
Armstrong.
Aye.
Crumbly?
Aye.
Harding?
Aye.
And Bodwin is aye. So motion carries. 15.1 is the naming of the weight room for in Zephyr Hills High School. I need a motion to approve.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make that motion. Altman.
A second?
Crumbly, second.
Thank you. All in favor? Oh, Altman?
Aye.
Armstrong?
Aye.
Crumbly?
Aye.
Harding?
Aye.
And Bodwin is aye. Motion carries. Now I need a motion to take an off-agenda item relating to the accepting the superintendent's recommendation to grant Day Spring and expansion of student enrollment to 920 for the 2020-2021 school year. So first I need a motion to take the off-agenda item.
Crumbly, Harding. So moved.
Motion by Crumbly, second by Harding. Okay, so indicate aye or nay. Altman?
Aye.
Armstrong?
Aye.
Crumbly?
Aye.
Harding?
Aye.
And Bodwin is aye, so it's approved to take the off-agenda item. Now I need a motion to pass 15.2, the agenda item relating to Day Spring.
Crumbly, so moved.
Harding, motion by Harding, second by Crumbly, I think. Yes. Okay, is there any discussion? Okay. Hearing none, I'm going to do the vote. So answer aye or nay, please. Altman?
Aye.
Armstrong?
Aye.
Crumbly?
Aye.
Harding?
Aye.
And Bodwin is aye, so motion carries. So we are an individual board member report. I'm going to stay with the same order of alphabetical order. So Mr. Altman.
Just quickly, I'm preaching to the choir tonight because everybody on this call already knows this, but I think it's just never been more evident that our schools are much more than education opportunities. What this system with our employees and community support has done to support families in the last month is nothing short of amazing. And I've visited these feeding sites and I've seen our employees engaged. I spoke to a lady at Pasco High the other day that was a bus driver who was there working, handing out food and, told me that she missed her students on the bus, but that she certainly was glad that she was being utilized and being helpful. And I've seen that everywhere I've gone. I know that Mr. Gadd and I have talked several times about the agricultural opportunities of providing fresh produce and fruits and vegetables and other things that our staff is working diligently in partnership with those that he mentioned and many others to try to do. So I just hope that when all of this is over with, as the saying at the beginning of the meeting, that even the darkest hour only has 60 minutes, this will end. And then when it does, that many people will remember how much the public school system contributed to the community and to those people being able to continue some semblance of life. And with that, I'm done. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Mr. Altman. Mrs. Armstrong.
Yes, just to tack on a little bit to Mr. Altman's comments. Yes, seeing the people in the feeding lines receiving the fresh corn and then today receiving the cucumbers, their appreciation, seeing the handmade thank you signs that the students have made and they hold up in the windows, really makes you appreciate what we're able to do for our students' families. The other thing I just quickly wanted to talk about was Mrs. Bodwin and I were on an FSBA webinar on Friday, which they're having every Friday at 9 o'clock. This one last Friday was with the Florida Department of Education Chancellor Jacob Oliva. It was very, very interesting to hear him answer the questions and to hear what he had to say. Just a couple of highlights that I got from it is, one, Department of Education still wants to make sure that we do have a robust attendance plan for attendance calculations, and it sounds like we certainly do have that in our county. The other thing that I thought was interesting, people need to know that as far as Bright Futures, they're still working on a plan for Bright Futures, how they're going to do those calculations with SAT and ACT kind of being on hold, but they are working on that. And something I just wanted to make sure everybody understood about the required EOCs, the Algebra 1 and then the 10th grade ELA, that when they waived those tests this year, they were waived only for the high school seniors. So anybody else that was taking Algebra 1 will need to take the EOC as a graduation requirement. So that's something we're going to have to provide support to those students when they're coming back after a long break from algebra and being required to take those tests. So that's something I think we need to start planning for. And then Mrs. Bodwin might add on to that, but those were the main highlights I took away from that.
Thank you, Mrs. Armstrong. Mrs. Crumbly?
Sure. I have to brag, too. Vanessa Hilton and your team includes the teachers and administrators. Wow to those numbers that you shared. The 98% engagement is unbelievable to me. And I cannot emphasize enough that this is not happening all over the country. I listened to a call-in type of podcast thing this morning from people all around the country, and our situation is not the norm. Many kids have no devices, and some districts aren't even doing anything. So the pride that we should have in our district is, and I think it's just going to each week grow and grow and grow, and I don't even have words to show the gratitude for all of you guys. It's really unbelievable. And as far as food distribution, Mr. Gadd, thanks for sharing the info about this summer food drive. I think that is going to be so necessary as we move forward. And Betsy, if you could please share again this gratitude that our board has for the ongoing work of FNS and all the people involved that are feeding our kids and families, and to the volunteers that show up at our feeding centers. The cucumbers today, the feeding center I went to, were a big hit, and this fresh food piece is going to be so helpful to keep their new nutrition up. Again, just no words, just gratitude. Thanks to everybody. I'm done.
Thank you, Mrs. Crumbly. Mrs. Harding?
I mean, I want to reiterate the same thing. I've been blown away. I have a lot of friends that are teachers in this county, and I've actually been on tons of Zoom meetings or Zooms with their students, and those students are engaged and they are excited to be there. Not to mention, they all, like, a couple of them had signs like for their background of like their teacher's name and I love you, and like just they miss their teachers. The teachers miss them. And but I'm just so thankful for all the hard work that Vanessa and all of her team has been doing. I'm just so grateful. Also to FNS, I'm blown away too. I've had so much positive feedback from that. So thank you. I do want to thank our superintendent for his leadership as well, because the news of having to do distant learning for the rest of the school year, it's really sad, but that was the right decision. So thank you for following with us with the governor's recommendation. I really appreciate it, so that we can keep our students and staff safe. We are really so lucky in Pasco to have such wonderful, passionate, and dedicated teachers and staff to ensure that our students are engaged in learning, as well as reminded how important and loved they are.
I did want to just make a comment to our seniors because I know how heartbreaking the news of that was. I had an opportunity to speak on a Zoom with the NTA yesterday, and a lot of them, they are so wise beyond their years, all those students are, and a lot of them just shared their feelings, and they were, they completely understood. However, I just wanted to let them know that their feelings are very valid and that I'm so proud of them. I'm so thankful for how hard they're working, and they've been so responsible and positive through all these changes. So I just want to remind them to finish strong and know that we're cheering you on, and that we are going to be creative and find ways to honor the class of 2020. I also wanted to give a little shout out to our parents and guardians, because I also know that this isn't something that they signed up for. And I know that they're trying to work from home and to help their child be academically successful. And they're also trying to keep their household afloat while ensuring their children are doing their schoolwork. I want to thank them for their partnership, because it means so much. I know, not just to me, but to our entire board and to our entire Pasco schools. I want to thank you for doing their best to balance it all. And I want to thank them for remaining positive and working through it with us. I want to thank them for being their child's biggest cheerleader and for reminding their child that they're doing amazing. And I also want to thank our community for their support, because we've gotten donations of computers, iPads, and foods. And so I want to thank them for being for cheering on and for being there for the children of Pasco. And then to our teachers and staff, I know how completely heartbroken that they are that the school is now on distant learning for the rest of the year. And then that if they would have known that March 13th would have been the last day with their students, they probably would have given a few more hugs, spent a few more minutes just talking with them, and made sure that you said, see you next school year. I know that their heart aches to be in their classroom with all their supplies and all their sweet and all those sweet faces, and that you wish that they could, and they know that they wish they could see their colleagues one more time. I want them to know that I understand, but that they're all rock stars, and I know that they're doing everything that they can for their students and their families. I understand the helplessness feeling when they can't just reach to the computer screen to help. Just want to remind them that we're all here cheering them on, that they're amazing, and that they're the MVPs, and that I'm so thankful for them. So keep on keeping on, and we're going to finish well and finish strong. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mrs. Harding. I attended the FSBA webinar that Mrs. Armstrong talked about last Friday with Chancellor Oliva, and he did answer a lot of questions. I did submit a couple questions in advance as well. He talked about the scholar designations on diplomas and said that students still need to meet some testing requirements. Also, I believe the Algebra EOC that Mrs. Armstrong referenced, that requirement can also be met through with geometry EOC scores. I took a few more notes, but I don't want to say some things that might get confusing, so I think I'm going to leave most of that communication to come from our chief academic officer, so that I'm not saying something that could have changed even since Friday. They're still working on a lot of the details. I appreciate, though, that he took time to meet with us and answer questions. He was even responding as people were typing questions into the chat box. And I want to thank our FSBA leadership. They are continuing to advocate for local control and flexibility because we understand the direct nuances of our own communities best. I was going to say a lot that I've been hearing from families, but I really want to thank the superintendent and staff for sharing their plans for graduation, because I have gotten quite a few phone calls and comments from people in our community, and everyone is very concerned about recognizing our seniors, and I know all of us and all of you share that angst. So thank you for these options that you've come up with, Superintendent Browning and staff. I know our staff and our school-based teachers recognize the loss that our students are experiencing in many things, our younger students as well. They're missing clap outs and field trips and award assemblies and recognition ceremonies, dances, proms, and yearbook signings. And our staff and our school-based teachers and leaders are looking for creative ways to celebrate those students and ways to honor them. And I'm very pleased that you're looking at these other options for graduation, because it is a rite of passage. I have seen our school-based teachers and leaders, and they are extremely creative in the way they're connecting with the students and each other. our principals and teachers are really going all out. Their posts have been entertaining, inspiring, innovative, and heartwarming. So thank you to all of them so much. I did want to just note that I'm sure the superintendent and staff are working on it, but I do want to note that I am concerned about the summer slide being exacerbated this summer, and I'm sure you're working on a plan to maintain some instructional continuity when we come back in August, and I look forward to hearing more about that as we get further along. Some good news I wanted to share. I don't think Mrs. Hilton mentioned it, but we got an email, and Angela Porterfield, Director of Early Childhood Programs, as you know, we have submitted the baseline grant application for the non-competitive five-year grant award, and it's due to the governing board, the superintendent's staff, a special thanks to Ms. Hilton, the district as a whole, the Head Start, Early Head Start staff, policy council, and our incredible families that we are eligible to apply for this non-competitive grant. Ms. Porterfield shared that the program is in full compliance, and she will work with finance to ensure we are in full compliance and with our real property state reports, and my sincere appreciation to this team. And just one last thank you to our staff, our teachers, our leaders, our students, our families, and our community members for their commitment to our students. A special thanks to those who worked on revising the workload for our elementary kids in response to the feedback that we received from parents. Thank you very much for working on that. Is there any other new business from staff?
Ms. Baldwin, this is Mrs. Harding. Can I just make one comment really quick?
Yes, of course.
I just want to remind the public that the lunch hero day that we voted on last board meeting is going to be on May 1st. So that's going to be after or before our next board meeting. So I just wanted to remind the public that if you have just when you're going to get your food or whatever, make sure you thank our fabulous lunch workers because they really are heroes.
Thank you, Mrs. Harding. Attorney Alfonso?
I have nothing, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Okay, the next school board meeting will be held on May 5th at 6 o'clock, and again, we'll be in this format. I need a motion to adjourn.
Meeting adjourned.
And the operator, the school board meeting is concluded. Thank you.
Thank you.